When can tenured professors be disciplined, even fired for things they say or write? This week, under pressure from students and politicians, the University of Pennsylvania Law School, my alma mater, announced it was initiating a sanction process against Professor Amy Wax over controversial things that she's written and said about race dating back to 2017. The current dust-up is over statements Wax made in December 20th, on the podcast of Brown University professor Glenn Lowry about immigrants from Asian countries.
There is this, let's call it danger of the dominance of an Asian elite in this country. And what does that mean? What is that going to mean to change the culture? And that's not a popular idea to say that. Like, why would you ever say anything?
Well, what's the danger? What would be wrong with having a lot of Chinese or of Indian or the Korean engineers, physicians, computer scientists, whatnot running around here, creating value, enlivening the society? I mean, I don't see how we lose from that. How do we lose from that?
Well, does the spirit of liberty beat in their breast, Glenn? That is my question.
In a written response to a listener, Wax further elaborated, "As long as most Asians support Democrats and help to advance their positions, I think the United States is better off with fewer Asians and less Asian immigration." She'd previously stirred outrage in another Lowry episode that was September of 2017, called "The Downside to Social Uplift," for saying this.
Here's a very inconvenient fact, Glenn. I don't think I've ever seen a Black student graduate in the top quarter of the class, and rarely in the top half. I can think of one or two students who've scored in the top half in my required first year course.
Wax added that she based her opinion on the performance of her own students because, quote, a lot of this data is closely guarded as a secret. At the time, the dean of Penn Law School, Theodore Ruger, fired back, saying her claims were false, telling the student newspaper, Black students have graduated in the top of the class at Penn Law, and contrary to any suggestion otherwise, Black students at Penn Law are extremely successful both inside and outside the classroom, in the job market, and in their careers. In 2019, Wax told a conservatism conference in Washington that the United States would be, quote, better off as a country if the immigration system favored immigrants from Western countries due to, quote, cultural compatibility, adding that embracing cultural distance nationalism means, in effect, taking the position that our country will be better off with more whites and fewer non-whites. Pretty ugly stuff, right? But tenure is supposed to be an ongoing gig for professors, extending to retirement, that frees them from career worries and not just financial ones. As the Penn Faculty Handbook explains, a system of tenure for faculty members is the preeminent means of fostering and protecting academic freedom of the faculty in teaching and in scholarly inquiry. And the only reasons it would ever end before retirement are resignation by death or by action of the trustees under the provisions for removal by just cause or by reason of financial exigency. Just cause. What might that mean? Well, again, per the handbook, a major infraction of university behavioral standards, an action involving flagrant disregard of standards, rules, or mission of the university or customs of scholarly communities. Pretty broad, but it goes on to list examples while warning that it is not a complete list. Everything from plagiarism to misusing university funds to harassing a member of the university community to sexual assault, rape, and murder. So, what compelled the dean of the law school, Ted Ruger, to feel that Wax's words warranted an elaborate university hearing process that could result in anything from a salary reduction to suspension or even termination? In a statement this week, Ruger wrote that, quote, her conduct has generated multiple complaints from members of our community, citing the impact of pervasive and recurring vitriol and promotion of white supremacy as cumulative and increasing. These complaints clearly call for a process that can fairly consider claims, for example, that her conduct is having an adverse and discernible impact on her teaching and classroom activities. Joining now is Keith Whittington, a professor of politics at Princeton University, who chairs the academic committee of the group known as Academic Freedom Alliance, which this week sent a letter to the University Law School defending Professor Wax's right to express her political views. Can we begin by agreeing that she has said some awfully repugnant stuff?
Sure, absolutely she has. It's stuff that I certainly disagree with, stuff I think is wrong on a policy matter. It's wrong as a moral matter. But often people wind up saying things that I disagree with and find offensive.
Would you go so far, Professor, as to say that she has made racist statements?
Well, I don't know if I would necessarily characterize it as that, although we'd have to go through the details of what exactly she said. I think the question ultimately is, it doesn't matter whether we want to characterize it as racist or something else. Universities are committed to protecting people as they express their political views in public, as individuals. Those are particularly strong protections about what people say on those kind of political issues in public life, for example, on a podcast. We ought to be very, very cautious before we try to punish someone for expressing them, even if we find those political views very disturbing.
Right, but I'm just trying to understand whether that extends to racism. I find this of interest. The Philadelphia Inquirer, the hometown newspaper here, in their coverage, put it up on the screen. There are no qualifiers in the way that they describe this. This was the lead paragraph this week. The University of Pennsylvania's law school dean Tuesday announced he would initiate a process that could lead to sanctions against longtime law professor Amy Wax for her racist comments. It kind of jumped out at me. There's not even a word alleged in there. And I'm wondering, if they're right, and arguably they are, does tenure even extend to racist statements?
Yeah, I think it does. And so the question becomes, in part, what the context is in which you're saying it. We tend to, at this point, given the kind of political debates that we're having these days, and given our polarization on these issues in particular, we see a lot of claims of racism that get bandied about. And if all it takes is an argument that somebody has said something that somebody wants to characterize as racist is enough to get a professor fired, we'll have a lot of fired professors as a consequence. I think there are very different standards, and traditionally universities have recognized very different standards about what it is, for example, people say in public as part of their political opinions on a podcast, for example, as opposed to what they might say in a classroom. The standards are very different about what somebody is saying in the classroom. If Amy Wax was saying similar kinds of things in a classroom, for example, different rules would apply, and she'd be in much more trouble. I think if she's saying it on a podcast, on the other hand, her protections are quite broad.
I hear you differentiating between the two, but if I'm a student of color, why would I even want to be in her classroom? Frankly, if I'm a black student at Penn, hasn't she just besmirched me by some revelation that exposes grading? There surely is some type of confidentiality that she violates when she says, well, I've never had a black student at the top of my class, whether that's accurate or inaccurate. If I'm now walking around, you know, on campus, how am I to feel?
No, certainly students, I think, are going to be offended and concerned when professors engage in this kind of speech. That's true in the Amy Wax situation. It's true in lots of other situations where professors make very broad claims, broader than they ought to make oftentimes, about groups of people, including groups of people who are going to be students in their classes. And students often object to that and say they don't trust those faculty as a consequence. Penn has a real obligation to make sure that she's, in fact, treating people fairly in the classroom and in her actual duties as a professor. If she's not grading people fairly, if she's not treating them fairly in the classroom, they have a responsibility to find that out, and if necessary, punish her and take steps as a consequence of that. But just because people are nervous about it, just because she's made people uncomfortable, that's not necessarily going to be sufficient.
Yeah, but this goes beyond. Look, first of all, I appreciate your willingness to have this kind of dialogue, because yours is, I think, a very unpopular point of view, but I appreciate that we can have the discussion. However, when she questions, quote, does the spirit of liberty beat in their breast? I'm an Asian student, and this professor questions, you know, whether I admire and see liberty as a virtue. To me, it's Potter Stewart, I guess, like pornography and knowing it when you see it. I think I see it.